Good afternoon. The first item of business this afternoon is portfolio questions, and the first portfolio is Rural Affairs, Land Reform and Islands. I remind members that questions 4 and 6 are grouped together and that I'll take any supplementaries on these questions after both have been answered. And at question number 1, I call Jeremy Balfour.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government how it plans to mitigate against crop damage over the coming months.
Minister Jim Fairley.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I am very aware of the diverse range of challenges that farmers are currently facing, and the Scottish Government places a very high priority in supporting farmers to mitigate against crop damage from a wide range of threats, notably from plant pests and disease, and in adapting to climate change. The Plant Health Centre and the Farm Advisory Service are key elements to that support, and we want to invest almost £50 million a year in a portfolio of strategic research to support advances in sustainable crop production, natural resources and the environment, including research that is aimed at improving crop resilience.
Jeremy Balfour.
Can I thank the Minister for his answer? But last year, Scotland's farmers had to endure extreme droughts, wildfires and a deluge of rain. And the delayed start to planting this year has already alarmed farmers about the coming months. Considering the Scottish Government's poor response to last year, can farmers and local residents expect anything different?
Minister.
Clearly, I disagree with what the member is saying to me. I think the Scottish Government's response was very good. I've already informed the Chamber that I co-hosted a flood resilience and water management roundtable with the sector earlier on this year. The Government has already put in £1.8 million, I think it is, of flood support available in terms of trying to do flood bank repairs. There is ongoing support and working with the industry, and this Government has a very good working relationship with the farming sector.
I call question number 2, Liz Smith.
To ask the Scottish Government what discussions the Rural Affairs Secretary has had with ministerial colleagues regarding action to support businesses in the rural economy to expand.
Minister.
I thank Liz Smith for that question. Now, the Cabinet Secretary for Rural Affairs and Land Reform and Islands is committed to building a prosperous and inclusive rural community and meets with ministerial colleagues to represent the interests of both rural businesses and communities, as I do myself. For example, alongside the Deputy First Minister, the Cabinet Secretary co-chairs the Rural Delivery Plan Ministerial Working Group. This group was established to ensure that government delivers for rural areas in a cohesive way, making best use of our collective resources to deliver sustainable outcomes for rural islands, rural coastal communities, including on economic development.
Could I thank the Minister for that? He will know that a recent survey from the Country Land and Business Association found that 73% of businesses are losing thousands of pounds of investments thanks to projects being held up by the planning process. And this is an issue that I would suggest is not just in the rural sector, but elsewhere. Can I ask the Minister what the Scottish Government is doing to address this concern about the planning process?
Minister.
The member raises a very good point, and planning has clearly been something that has been raised across the chamber by a number of people. I go back to the point that we have a joint ministerial working group. We talk about these issues on a regular basis. There are specific ones that are in the member's region and in my constituency, which we know that are there, but we are very cognisant to it, and we're definitely working towards finding proper solutions for them.
And supplementary, Emma Roddick, who is joining us online. Ms Roddick.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Does the Minister agree with me that just this once, before they're booted out the door, the Tories should be honest with rural businesses and communities, acknowledge the damage that they have caused, and apologise for the barriers that they've created for businesses and the havoc that their policies have caused for Scotland's rural economy?
Minister, if there's anything you can extract that falls within your jurisdiction and responsibility, then please do so. Otherwise, please just don't bother.
The member is absolutely correct to say that we have got a range of problems that have come from for the rural community as a result of things that have happened via Westminster, and Brexit being the obvious one to that. But I'll leave the politics to this moment in time.
I call question number 3, Liam MacArthur.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government what discussions the Rural Affairs Secretary has had with ministerial colleagues regarding the potential link between agricultural support and rural depopulation.
Cabinet Secretary Mary Gujol.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Our vision for agriculture is one in which rural communities thrive and that more people, not less, can live and work sustainably on our land, something that's regularly discussed with ministerial colleagues. Through a phased approach as outlined in our agricultural reform route map, future agricultural support will improve the resilience, efficiency and profitability of the sector. I also oversee the rural component of our Addressing Depopulation Action Plan, which strategically supports communities facing population decline. And we will continue to engage with rural partners to deliver the right support, ensuring sustainable communities both now and into the future.
Lee MacArthur.
Thank you. Recent SRUC research has looked at the risks and opportunities for Orkney, Shetland and the Western Isles from changes in agricultural policy and support. While differences exist between each island group, all three boast high levels of environmental designations, priority habitats and species. In all three, agriculture accounts for a higher share of business activity and employment compared to Scotland as a whole, with a larger multiplier effect across the economy from any investment made. Given this and the challenges faced in sustaining populations and building community resilience, what commitment can the Cabinet Secretary give that future policy and support will reflect the findings of this research? And does she accept that what happens to farming and crofting matters economically, environmentally and socially to our islands?
Cabinet Secretary.
I thank the member for that question because I think there are a number of really important points that the member raises within that. I think firstly, just touching on the research element, this is a report that had also been raised with me by the Scottish Crofting Federation, and I believe that it is due to publish shortly. So as with anything, I think the more data, the more information and the more research that we have to help inform our policy decisions can only be a good thing. So I would like to give him that assurance that, of course, we will be considering that report as we look to continue our journey on agricultural reform and developing policy, and we'll of course look to work closely in terms of the other elements that he's discussed there, because I absolutely recognise how important agriculture is to our rural communities, but particularly to our island communities too, and the member's own constituency in Orkney.
And supplementary, Emma Harper.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. In some parts of Scotland, people are farming and crofting in the most marginal and challenging of circumstances. Does the Cabinet Secretary share my concern that any undermining of Scotland's ability to tailor agricultural payments to the specific needs of our sector in the future, potentially rendering certain types of farming and crofting unviable, could be a catalyst for people leaving agriculture and their communities? And that is why it is absolutely vital the devolved nature of agriculture is not undermined.
Cabinet Secretary.
The member raises a really critical point here, and that's where our ability to design a support that works for our farmers and our crofters and land managers in Scotland is so critical, because we have very particular types of support here that don't exist elsewhere in the UK to recognise the type of landmass that we have in Scotland. And I think one example which illustrates that is our LFAS payments. We know how critical that is for people who are working on some of our most marginal land. And that's why we've had concerns throughout the passage of bills such as the Subsidy Control Act and the Internal Market Act, because of the threat and the potential that they have to undermine our ability to develop policy that works for Scotland. But that's why we will continue to develop policy here by working with our farmers and crofters to deliver a future framework of support that will work for them.
Question number four, Kevin Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what analysis it has undertaken to consider the impact that Brexit has had on Scottish food and drink exports.
Cabinet Secretary.
The food and drink growth sector is a major contributor to Scotland's economy and is Scotland's biggest non-energy export. The Scottish food and drink sector continues to be impacted by a range of issues, including Brexit, with many parts of the sector suffering from lower exports to the EU post-Brexit, including a 45% fall in fruit and vegetable exports between 2019 and 2023.
Kevin Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Meat producers, seed potato growers and many other food manufacturers have been severely impacted by Brexit. And Salmon Scotland has revealed that Scotland lost up to £100 million a year in salmon exports to the EU because of Brexit. Unsurprisingly, the Westminster parties are too feared to talk about the damage caused by Brexit. Can the Cabinet Secretary assure me that the SNP Scottish Government will always highlight Brexit chaos, stand up for our food and drink industry, and do everything possible to get Scotland back at the heart of Europe?
Cabinet Secretary.
I can absolutely assure the member on all of those fronts. And he raises some really important points and identifies really critical industries for us in Scotland, not least seed potatoes, which are so important for us in the northeast of Scotland. Now, Scotland is, of course, paying a high price for Brexit that it didn't vote for, and the food and drink sector has undoubtedly been impacted, and the figures and costs that we've seen set out really lay that situation bare. We've highlighted repeatedly to the UK government the chaos that they've inflicted through their hard Brexit, and of course we will continue to do that, and we will continue to stand up for our food and drink industry. But I think what really is astonishing is that neither the Tories, Labour or the Liberal Democrats are arguing to reverse Brexit, and that's why I absolutely agree with the member. The only way that we can escape this economic disaster is for Scotland to become an independent country and an equal member of the European Union.
Question number six, Marie McNair.
To ask the Scottish Government when they last met the UK Government to discuss the impacts of Brexit on Scotland's food and drink exports.
Cabinet Secretary.
The Scottish Government has taken every opportunity to engage with the UK Government to press on the impact of Brexit on Scotland's food and drink sector. Now, the formal mechanism that we have for this is the Interministerial Group for Environment, Food and Rural Affairs, which last met on the 13th of September last year. Unfortunately, though, this group hasn't met since then, as UK government ministers have pulled out of subsequent meetings. There are also regular meetings at official level, which cover a range of post-Brexit issues that have an impact on Scotland's food and drink sector.
Marie McNair.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. The outgoing UK government imposed a deeply damaging, costly Brexit on my constituents and the economy, given the academic think tank UK in a Changing Europe has said that Labour's EU plan will have minimal impact on the cost of Brexit. I'm glad the Cabinet Secretary agrees with me that only real change away from the disaster of Brexit will come when Scotland becomes an independent country with full membership of the EU.
Cabinet Secretary.
I thank the member for that question, because I think there really is overwhelming evidence that the UK government's irrational hard Brexit continues to cause significant economic damage to Scotland and indeed to the whole of the UK. And I think, for example, just in May this year, the Institute of Directors said that 46% of its members were finding EU trade challenging, and that 57% of its members who import or export identifying new customs regulations as the key problem. So therefore, that's why I completely agree with Marie McNair that the only way forward is for Scotland to become an independent country with full membership of the EU.
And supplementary, Edward Mountain.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer, and I remind members of my declaration of interest that I am part of a family farming partnership growing crops and beef. Cabinet Secretary, exports to the European Union of British beef are banned because of blue tongue, which only came into this country through Europe. Does the minister think that the EU, which is where blue tongue is rife, is right to ban imports from these countries?
Cabinet Secretary.
I think the member, first of all, raises a really important point, and I think it's vital that we take action on all these fronts to try and prevent the import of these diseases. And that's why it's been really frustrating, actually, in terms of the engagement that we've had on the border target operating model with the UK government. Now, we had agreed to endorse that model originally because we need to take what action we can to prevent the import of diseases such as what the member has mentioned. However, there's been a severe lack of engagement from the UK government in relation to that, in relation to our west coast and qualifying Northern Ireland goods. So perhaps the member might wish to raise this with colleagues that he has within the UK government to ask them to engage with us constructively on these matters so that we can really try and address these issues.
Question number five, Emma Roddick, who's joining us online. Ms Roddick.
To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide further details of how the Small Producers Pilot Fund has supported micro-businesses in Scotland.
Minister.
I'd like to thank the member for that question, because it's a vitally important one. We are utterly committed to small producers, and this pilot is just the first step towards this commitment. Limited as it is, by our present powers and capabilities. And the fund has been developed in partnership with the very industry that the member refers to, and she was aware that earlier this year the Cabinet Secretary for Rural Affairs and Land Reform in Islands confirmed a £1 million resource funding. So far, we have supported two small-scale abattoir projects, developments of the Small Producer Info Hub website, and are currently in the process of procuring a practical training fund, all of which support small producers.
Emma Roddick.
I thank the Minister for that response, and I was aware of the £180,000 last year through the fund, and as he mentioned, amongst those projects awarded was the support for two mobile abattoirs. Many in my region are keen that these become a normal site for agricultural workers who often struggle to travel to Dingwall or Mull, a journey that may often include multiple ferries and or lengthy road trips for farmers and their animals. Is the Scottish Government considering further support for such schemes?
Minister.
The member raises a very, very important point, but the Cabinet Secretary publicly directed that the pilot steering group explore solutions for challenges regarding the accessibility to abattoirs and sufficient throughput. They conducted an abattoir survey, which has now been published, and I'll be happy to share that with the member. Their continued support for abattoirs will be considered for this financial year, following a review of the funding date to date. And we will continue to work with smaller producers to ensure that the right support for their needs is developed with them. And this pilot is a step towards ensuring that essential role of this cohort is recognised and rewarded appropriately.
And supplementary, Rosie Grant.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The distribution of support funding is disproportionately targeted towards large farms. This £1 million funding pot actually equates to £143 per year for the small producers that are registered. And if you take, for example, that large farms receive £223 per hectare per annum, that shows the discrepancy between the funding. What action is the Scottish Government taking to ensure fair distribution of support?
Minister.
As I said in the answer to the previous member, this is a pilot fund and the Scottish Government has absolutely committed, as we've just been through the new Agricultural Reform and Communities Bill, to working with small producers to make sure that they get the absolute maximum support that they can get through what we develop as the development of this programme.
Question number 7, Kenneth Gibson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what discussions it has had with the Scottish Association for Marine Science about its research into reducing the deaths of cetaceans from fishing line entanglements.
Cabinet Secretary.
The Scottish Government is aware of the research into entanglement of sensitive marine species in creel lines, and we're currently considering its findings. Now, we welcome the ongoing support from fishers to trial solutions to reduce such entanglement events and the role of SAMs in this work. We are fully committed to tackling this issue, and through the future catching policy, we'll be working with stakeholders to deliver action to reduce and, where possible, eliminate bycatch and entanglement of sensitive marine species as part of a wider effort to ensure the sustainability of our fisheries.
Kenneth Gibson.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that response. Creeling is a low-impact form of fishing. However, rope used to connect the creels is causing an ever greater number of cetaceans, such as porpoises, humpback and minke whales, as well as basking sharks, to drown after being entangled. A trial of sinking ground line, which is only slightly heavier than standard rope, with creel boats operating around the North West Highlands, has proven to be a simple and effective method of reducing the risk of entanglement in static gear. Therefore, will the Scottish Government explore facilitating a wider rollout of sinking ground line across the static gear fleet to ensure Scotland retains its position as a European leader in marine mammal conservation?
Cabinet Secretary.
First of all, I really want to thank the member for raising this research, because we're always interested when it comes to research reports such as this and its findings, and that's why we'll be giving it our full consideration. Now, I've just mentioned our future catching policy, and as part of the discussions that we're taking forward in relation to that, we'll be arranging a stakeholder workshop on sensitive species bycatch this summer, and we'll be using that meeting as an opportunity to discuss the findings of this report with the industry. Now, our vision for fisheries in Scotland has sustainable management at its heart, and we support good practice by the fishing industry, and we are really pleased to see the level of support from fishers to trial solutions to reduce marine animal entanglements as part of this project.
And supplementary, Peter Swishart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Kenneth Gibson's right to highlight the ongoing work to try solutions to prevent cetacean deaths. Entanglement also poses risks to seabirds like gannets and is a danger to shipping. Damage from ghost fishing gear to the propeller of Northlink's freight vessel MV Hellier recently took her out of the lifeline service for weeks. So what efforts is being made by the Scottish Government to prevent ghost fishing gear and thereby reduce entanglements, which are a danger to sea life, fishing and shipping?
Cabinet Secretary.
Again, the member raises some really important points there, and I think in relation to seabirds, we have the seabird conservation strategy and work ongoing in that regard. But in relation to discarded fishing gear, as she mentions, we're actually currently supporting the development of a European standard for recyclability and circularity in fishing and aquaculture gear. And that standard will provide the guidance and encourage designers, makers and users to adopt best practice and available technologies to ensure that gear stays in use for as long as possible, and that includes the retrieval in the event of it being lost. And I think there are also a number of important initiatives that we're part of to help tackle this problem, and one of those is the Global Ghost Gear Initiative and KEMO's Fishing for Litter Initiative to promote behaviour change. And I think by supporting projects such as that and by undertaking these other advances in other areas, hopefully we're taking a rounded approach to really try to get to grips with those problems.
Question number 8, Graeme Simpson.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government when it plans to deliver on its commitment to produce a national register of ancient woodland.
Cabinet Secretary.
A new National Register of Ancient Woodlands is an important element of the Scottish Biodiversity Strategy and Delivery Plan, which we consulted on last year. We've been discussing with Nature Scot and Scottish Forestry the best approach to developing a new register of ancient woodlands, which will build on the existing Scottish Ancient Woodland Inventory.
Graeme Simpson.
I can thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer, but she didn't actually say when the Government plans to deliver on that. So I accept there have been talks and consultations, but if we're to be able to protect and restore our ancient woodland, we need to know where it is, and we need to know how much of it there is and what condition it's in. So can I urge the Cabinet Secretary to perhaps have another go at the original question and tell me when we're going to see this?
Cabinet Secretary.
The member raises really important points within that, and I completely understand and agree with him about the importance of this piece of work. And I absolutely recognise and would admit that it hasn't progressed, I think, as quickly as any of us would have liked, and I do fully appreciate that. But that's because the focus of the work that we've been taking forward has really been focused on the biodiversity strategy and the delivery plan that comes from that. Now, this has been a really complex piece of work because it involves a range of organisations that obviously have an interest in the delivery of that. Now, again, I am completely aware of the importance of providing this piece of work, and I can offer the assurance that now that we're through that first stage of the strategy and we're moving into the delivery phase, that work will be prioritised so as to help us ensure our important ancient woodlands are protected. But I'd be more than happy to keep the member informed as we progress that work.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. That concludes the portfolio questions on Rural Affairs, Land Reform and Islands. There were a few members I was unable to take, but they actually were not here for the start of the question session. There will be a short pause before we move on to the next item of business. Thank you.
Okay, the next item of business is portfolio questions, and the portfolio now is NHS Recovery, Health and Social Care. The usual plea for those looking to ask a supplementary question to press the request to speak buttons during the relevant question, and I call question number 1, Edward Mountain.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government, in light of reports that capital expenditure work has now been stopped at Raigmore Hospital, when it will publish its plan for the Moray Maternity Services redesign.
Minister Jenny Minto.
Thank you. The Scottish Government has approved the plan submitted by NHS Grampian and NHS Highland for reintroduction of obstetric maternity services to Dr Grays on the 3rd of March 2023, backed by up to £6.6 million of Scottish Government investment, and we remain committed to this plan. NHS Grampian have a dedicated Moray Maternity webpage and publish on it their regular newsletter, which they also share with public and local elected members. The March edition of the newsletter included a summary of the plan and a working timeline.
Edward Mayne.
And I thank the Minister for that answer, but as she well knows, all capital works have stopped and maternity provision across the Highlands, especially for Caithness mothers, is shocking. Given that £2.7 million has already been spent on this project by NHS Highland and they're potentially £70 million overspent, surely the government must accept that their whole handling of the Murray maternity redesign has been shambolic and nothing short of wicked.
Minister.
I thank the member for his question. With regard to Murray maternity services at Dr Gray's, I'm really pleased to be able to say that both NHS Grampian and NHS Highland have moved forward with delivery of the plan. In addition to delivering the first three milestones above, the following is underway as well. They have recently appointed three obstetricians and one paediatrician, and ongoing recruitment of specialist midwives, anaesthetists and speciality midwives, and continued expansion of the day case assessment is continuing. Finalising operating models for neonatal care and intraparatum obstetric care. So work is absolutely continuing, and I meet regularly with both my officials, who meet regularly with NHS Grampian to discuss progress.
Supplementary, Emma Harper.
Thank you, President Officer. Regarding capital works, the UK Government's decision to cut the Scottish Government's capital budget for the next 5 years by nearly 9% in real terms has had a severe impact on healthcare projects. Can the Minister advise of any conversations held with the UK Government on this matter? And will she join me in calling to reverse these harsh cuts to ensure Scotland's health service infrastructure can be significantly improved?
Minister.
I thank Emma Harper for her question and agree that it is incredibly disappointing that the Scottish Government's capital budget was reduced. Our block grant for capital is expected to reduce in real terms, as Ms Harper has said, of around 9% by 2027. That's a cumulative loss of over £1.3 billion. Ahead of both the UK Autumn Statement in November and the UK Spring Budget in March, the Finance Secretary called on the UK Government to reverse the cuts and provide clarity around the future of our financial transactions. Sadly, no clarity and no additional capital or financial transactions funding for Scotland was forthcoming.
Question 2 was withdrawn. Question 3, Monica Lennon.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will proceed with its reported plans to downgrade the neonatal intensive care unit at University Hospital Wishaw.
Minister.
Thank you. The decision to move to three neonatal intensive care units has been made on the basis of clinical evidence that tells us that this change will improve outcomes for the very smallest and sickest babies. As agreed when I met Monica Lennon and Wishaw constituents in November, I have considered again the data and evidence in relation to the proposals and have taken additional advice from clinical advisers who were not part of the Best Start process for identifying the location of units, and am assured about the validity of the evidence base, the process and the conclusions reached. The Scottish Government commissioned independent modelling report was published on the 29th of May, and following consideration of that report, we've asked the regional chief executives to progress with the development of implementation plans. The Scottish Government is now consulting with families on implementation of the proposals so that we can take account of their concerns when the pathways and processes for the new model of care are designed. An online survey is being developed, and this will be followed by targeted focus groups to listen to the concerns of parents in Scotland and inform implementation plans.
Monica Lennon.
I thank the Minister for that response. She will know that almost 23,000 people have signed a petition urging the Scottish Government to stop the downgrading of Lanarkshire's neonatal intensive care unit. And it's important that my constituents believe that their voices are being heard. Cabinet Secretary, the Scottish Government says that parents are key partners in the care of their babies and that we should do everything possible to keep mothers and babies together. That being said, how can the Scottish Government continue with these devastating downgrading plans? Because it would ignore the pleas to save the neonatal intensive care unit and force families to be apart at a vulnerable and critical time.
Minister.
Thank Monica Lennon for her question. The new model of care is firmly based on clinical evidence, as recommended, as I've said before, by a group of neonatal experts. With regards to ensuring that babies and parents remain close, We have the Young Persons Family Fund, which will support people, and also the hospitals that will have the intensive neonatal care units will have suitable accommodation alongside to ensure that that important bonding time happens. And this is all part of the plans that we are asking the NHS health boards to work through to ensure that we have the best results.
Supplementary, Claire Adamson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. It's welcome that the local neonatal units will continue to offer care for the vast majority of babies, including a level of neonatal intensive care. For clarity, can the Minister reaffirm that the plans are about ensuring that with preemptive planning, the smallest babies are born when they can readily access the specialist care and services they need, including neonatal surgery, not currently available at Wishaw, and in line with expert clinicians' advice?
Minister.
I would like to reaffirm that the new model of care is firmly based on clinical advice and recommended by a group of neonatal experts, which shows that the most preterm and sickest babies do best when they are cared for in larger specialist neonatal units, which look after a lot of these babies and have specialist staff and services available on site to give them the very best care. We are doing this to give babies born at the extremes of prematurity the best chance of survival. I believe this is what every parent wants for their baby.
And briefly, Martin Whitfield.
I'm very grateful, Deputy Presiding Officer. Can the Minister confirm that the clinical analysis and advice that she's been given was in respect as what was given in what is right for the baby and mother, or the family?
Minister.
The advice that I have received is from experts with regard to looking after babies in a neonatal care situation. That advice has always looked at the baby in the round, and that's why we're continuing to ensure that I get the right advice from the right groups of people to move this forward.
Question 4, Gordon MacDonald.
To ask the Scottish Government what assessment it has made of the impact of inflation on health and social care services in Scotland.
Cabinet Secretary Neil Gray.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Spiralling UK inflation has had a devastating impact on all public services, including health and social care. In spite of this, we've provided over £19.5 billion for the health and social care budget, giving our NHS a real terms uplift. Despite this investment, the system is under extreme pressure as a result of the ongoing impacts of COVID, Brexit and inflation, and the UK government spending decisions. So hard choices, greater efficiencies and savings will need to be made. We assess inflation and the impact on health and social care services regularly, and this features in the development of the Scottish public sector pay policy, and we will publish our health and social care portfolio medium-term financial framework later this summer, which sets out expected inflation levels linked to the GDP deflated rates, and that will be updated on an annual basis as new information becomes available.
Gordon MacDonald.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. It's not just inflation, but years of UK government spending cuts that have continued to have a detrimental impact on the Scottish Government's ability to provide the level of funding that our health and social care services deserve. The Minister highlighted the impact of the UK Government cuts to our budget. So how does the Cabinet Secretary envisage that we can protect our public services like the NHS from increased privatisation and future cuts?
Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Gordon MacDonald's right. A decade and a half of Tory austerity has had a clear impact, and our ability to continue to mitigate against that is becoming harder and harder. The UK Government has ignored the calls from this Government to prioritise investment in public services and infrastructure, and while I welcome the additional resource funding that was received at the Spring Budget, the £237 million provided is only around half of the £470 million consequentials from 23-24, which have not been baselined in full into 24-25. This is clearly a very disappointing situation and sets a challenging fiscal context. It also serves to illustrate the continued shortchange that has been offered by the Labour Party of just £134 million additional for the Scottish Government for health. The UK Government's own figures show that the Department for Health and Social Care funding for 24-25 is 0.2% less in real terms than in 23-24. before, while we've provided a real terms increase of 3%. That's just one example. On a resource perspective, I could obviously point to the capital side and why Wes Streeting was absolutely right when he said the pressures in Wales are because all roads are leading to Westminster.
Thank you. Question 5, Bob Doris, who joins us remotely.
Thank you, President Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on the levels of uptake for baby and child immunisation programmes, including any emerging trends.
Minister.
Quarterly and annual childhood immunisation rates across Scotland remain high, reflecting both the hard work and commitment of our colleagues in the NHS and the recognition of the benefits of vaccination. However, there have been decreases in uptake compared with previous years, a trend which has been observed globally. We are working with Public Health Scotland and health boards to improve vaccination uptake, address health inequalities and support those eligible for vaccination. We urge parents and guardians of young children to bring them for vaccination when invited to give them the best protection against serious disease.
Bob Doris.
I thank the Minister for that answer. And of course, the sharp increase in whooping cough cases, with 3,650 cases confirmed in the first half of 2024 in Scotland, and sadly, deaths in England, highlights the vital importance of childhood vaccinations, indeed in this case also for pregnant mums. More generally, however, Minister, vaccinations offer protection from a variety of dangerous conditions, and whilst immunisation rates remain high, as pointed out by the Minister, they are dipping. Can the Scottish Government outline how it seeks to ensure we maintain high levels of uptake right across society, including, for instance, within lower income areas in my constituency of Maryhill and Springburn, or indeed groups with a history of vaccine hesitancy?
Minister.
I thank Mr Doris for his question, and in fact this morning I was at the Scottish Vaccination Improvement, I met with the Scottish Vaccination Improvement Programme, which is a partnership between Public Health Scotland, health boards and the Scottish Government. And that was exactly what we were talking about, the importance of vaccination as one of the most effective public health interventions that we can make throughout our population. As Mr Doris has highlighted, recent cases, an increase in cases of parasitis, illustrate the importance of health boards continuing to promote the benefits of vaccines and ensuring that access to vaccines is straightforward, timely and equitable. Public Health Scotland has developed a range of social media toolkits and translated assets in a number of different languages to support this work, as well as working with health boards and available data to target their efforts where most needed, for example, in the areas of deprivation where uptake may be lower. And as I've said, parents and guardians also have a vital role by bringing children forward for immunisation when called to ensure that they get the best protection. And I think that's something else we as elected members can also promote as well.
Thank you. I've got a couple of supplementaries. I'll try to get them both in, but they will need to be brief, as will the responses. First, Faisal Chowdhury.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. It is known immunisation rates are lower among those living in more deprived areas and BME communities due to various factors, including lack of trust or a lack of information. Can the Minister advise what the measure of the Scottish Government is taking to increase uptake of vacancies by the groups?
Minister.
I think Mr Chowdhury raises a very important point, and though not specifically with regards to vaccinations, I have met with BME communities with regard to organ donation and such like, and I think, and I was sharing that at the meeting I was at this morning. I think it's incredibly important that we reach all groups, and as I said to Mr Doris's answer, our social media content has been in a number of languages.
And briefly, Carol Mochan, who joins us remotely.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. My question is in a similar vein to my colleagues around the more likely lower vaccination rate in more deprived areas. I'm quite interested to know whether the Minister thinks there's more we could do cross-portfolio to see if we can ensure that uptake in these areas reaches the same standards across the rest of Scotland.
Minister.
I thank Carol Mochan for her question and I agree with her. I think there is work and we are doing work cross-portfolio to ensure that we improve healthcare in areas that are facing inequalities. Not only cross-portfolio, but I'd be very happy to work cross-chamber as well and meet with both Ms Mochan and Mr Chowdhury to discuss this area further.
Question six, Alec Rowley.
Presiding officer, to ask the Scottish Government what action it's taken to ensure that scheduled care transport provided by the Scottish Ambulance Service is accessible to all patients who need it.
Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Scottish Government recognises that transport plays a key role in supporting patients' health journeys and prepared the Transport to Health Delivery Plan in summer 2023. This plan outlines 16 commitments across health and social care to and for Transport Scotland. The Scottish Ambulance Service plays a key role in supporting patients to access scheduled healthcare appointments. They carry out a needs-based assessment for each patient to determine eligibility for clinical support during transfer to appointments, and this assessment helps to ensure that the Transport Service is available to all those patients who need it.
Alec Rowley.
Thank you. I raised this question because in recent months I've had quite a number of constituents contact me and talk about the difficulty they've had in accessing transport. One lady, for example, for five, who had to attend Edinburgh for radiotherapy, was told she didn't meet the eligibility criteria. She was in her 80s. She was told she could use the bus, public transport, which would have taken three buses either way. She physically just was not able to do it. So can the Minister have a look at these kind of issues and tell me, has the eligibility criteria been changed? It came as a shock to her cancer nurse, I have to say, when told she was not eligible because the eligibility criteria had changed. And is this simply cuts by the back door?
Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you. I thank Alec Rowley for his question, which is an incredibly serious one, especially as we represent rural communities and those who are needing to access healthcare services in an equitable fashion. We need to make sure that our patient transport system works effectively. And to directly address the last point that he made, no, it's not. It's obvious that the Scottish Ambulance Service continually reviews patient eligibility. It's right that they do so as patients' eligibility will change based on the fluctuation of their circumstances. But it's also right that the Scottish Ambulance Service takes into account the patient's condition and takes a decision based on that. So I'd be concerned about, obviously I don't have the full details of the case that Mr Rowley raises, but I'd be concerned about the example that he's been given there and ask for more detail about that so that I can interrogate that further to ensure that we are offering a situation that allows people to equitably access those healthcare services that we want to see them delivered to.
Brief supplementary, Alexander Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I ask the Cabinet Secretary about the patient transport online booking service, which is provided by NHSNet? That has had and continues to be well used, but can I ask about what access and availability, because as we've already heard, there are log jams within the system. And in some parts of the country, they are having some difficulty fulfilling all the proposals that they need to do.
Cabinet Secretary.
So I haven't had... I thank Mr Stewart for raising that. That's not a situation that I've had communicated to me as yet, and if there are particular examples that Mr Stewart would wish to furnish me with so that I can provide a further investigation, I'd be happy to do so and reply in writing on the basis of those.
Thank you. Question 7, Liam Kerr.
Very grateful. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on what action it is taking to tackle long ambulance turnaround times.
Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Scottish Ambulance Service continually engages with health boards whilst optimising services, including flow navigation centres and the integrated clinical hubs, which provide care for patients at or near home, reducing pressure on accident emergency departments. The call before you convey protocol is also being utilised, and cohorting areas have been established at challenging sites, ensuring ambulance crews are freed up during high demand periods.
Liam Kerr.
Well, people in the North East were shocked to read reports of a 96-year-old woman waiting outside ARI for 9 hours due to ambulance stacking, who hadn't eaten for 14 hours by the time she got admitted. Now, we must be clear that everyone from the ambulance crew to the hospital staff did their jobs well, but the turnaround times they're expected to work with are already unacceptable and becoming unbelievable. So after 17 years of the SNP in charge of our health service, what is the Cabinet Secretary doing specifically at ARI to prevent stacking? And does he think it's acceptable to have elderly patients starving and in agony for hours with help just out of reach?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, no, clearly, I thank Liam Kerr for his question. Clearly, the example that he cites is unacceptable. There is no defending that. It is unacceptable. And I apologise to the patient in question and their family for the situation that they have endured. In terms of the direct action we're taking with NHS Grampian around the pressures that there are around the ARI, I have asked for an improvement plan which will see the pressures both in the accident and emergency department, but also throughout the hospital to be addressed. There are pressures not just for our ambulance service and accessing the hospital, but the flow through the hospital. We're also taking action, direct action with a joint mission with COSLA on reducing delayed discharge because our occupancy, hospital occupancy across Scotland is too high, and that is stopping the flow through the hospital as well. But it's also fair to say that ambulance stacking is not a unique phenomenon either to the ARI or indeed to Scotland, and it is a situation that's faced elsewhere in the UK. That's not to say that it is okay in Scotland, it's just reflective of the fact that there are significant pressures upon our health and social care services across
Thank
the
you,
UK.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. I'm going to have to get a supplementary in, Kenneth Gibson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can the Cabinet Secretary confirm that despite fiscal constraints as a result of Westminster Tory cuts, the Scottish Government provided £349.2 million to the Scottish Ambulance Service this year, an increase of £15 million on the previous year, and will he provide details of how this funding will be used to recruit additional staff to increase capacity and improve the service?
Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, President Officer. I thank Kenneth Gibson for that question. The Scottish Government recognises the extreme pressure that the system is under and is as a result of the ongoing impacts of COVID, Brexit and inflation, as well as UK Government spending decisions. So we've therefore provided almost £550 million of additional investment to frontline-facing NHS boards as part of the 24-25 Scottish Budget. The Scottish Ambulance Service received £15 million of this increased investment, taking their funding to nearly £350 million to support the delivery of their services. And we continue to invest in the Scottish Ambulance Service workforce, have provided funding of £45 million on a recurrent basis in 23-24 to support increases in the board's capacity, and includes funding for the recruitment of 1,388 additional staff since 2020, with over 230 recruited in 23-24.
Thank you. Question 8, Rose McCall.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what action it is taking to reduce waiting times for CAMHS in NHS Fife.
Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. We continually monitor CAMHS waiting times performance, engage with all boards, including NHS Fife, and direct tailored support to those with the longest waits, providing access to professional advice. NHS Fife have made improvements in recent months to their waiting list for CAMHS. Since June 23 to the latest published statistics at the end of March, there have been a 25% decrease in the waiting list, a 41% decrease in patients waiting over 18 weeks. That is to the credit of the staff in Fife, who should be commended for their hard work in achieving this. Boards were allocated £55.5 million in 23-24 via the Mental Health Outcomes Framework to improve the quality and delivery of mental health services, including CAMHS, in addition to the core funding that health boards receive.
Rose McCall.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that response. And I know he's highlighting improvements, but there is a mental health crisis amongst our young people. And the Scottish Government have repeatedly pledged action, but actually nothing has changed when you look at the other stats. NHS Fife Area's latest data from March 24 shows that there's still 41 young people waiting up to 35 weeks for a follow-up appointment following a referral, which has barely moved from the 47 young people that were waiting over 35 weeks in March last year. Even more worrying is the fact that during the same period, 31% referrals were rejected altogether, leaving many seeking help from charities, which is almost identical to the 33% recorded also in the previous year.
Question.
So that's another year gone by. So when will the Scottish Government stop promising and actually do something?
The Secretary.
Well, I've already set out, I thank Rose McCall for her question and the attention that she's putting on the importance of the investment that we're making in child and adolescent mental health service. We have increased investment, we have increased support through the workforce. And pointing again to the figures that were quoted by Rose McCall, for those waiting 19 to 35 weeks, in June last year it was 70, This year it is 40, in March it is 41. You know, it's clearly for those people that are waiting that length of time that is not acceptable, but we are seeing an improvement in those services. So it is not fair to say that decisions we've taken have had no impact. They are having an impact. It's also not fair to say that those that have a rejected referral means that there is no help or support for those children. As a specialist service, CAMHS will only be the right support for a small proportion of children and young people, and the national CAMHS specification includes a clear expectation that children and young people whose referral is not accepted are sensitively and appropriately signposted to more suitable services. So we are investing, we are making improvements. I want to see those improvements happen faster, which is why we'll continue to
support. Thank you. I'm going to take a very brief supplementary. It will need to be brief, as will the response. Paul Sweeney.
The Psychotherapy and Counselling Union met with me today, and they raised the point that there are often no other means of referral apart from CAMHS. So loading pressure onto CAMHS is actually part of a vicious cycle with cuts to mental health spending across the board in community settings, primary care settings, educational settings. Is that not compounding the pressure we're seeing, not just in CAMHS, but across our mental health services in the NHS?
There hasn't been a cut to mental health services. I don't know where Paul Sweeney is getting that from. There has been a substantial increase, a near doubling in the funding available for mental health, and a clear investment that's been made in CAMHS. And that is why we're able to see an increase in the workforce supporting CAMHS referrals, and why we're seeing a better referral to treatment performance. It's not where we want it to be, but it is the best performance that we have had in a decade. So I'm very grateful to the frontline staff that are performing, working so hard, performing so well, to make sure we're providing the services to those children and young people that need those services.
Thank you. That concludes portfolio questions on NHS recovery, and there'll be a brief pause before we move to the next item of business.